I think we'll wait for a minute or two and then we can start. So I hope everyone's gone through the lectures. I think this week has been a little bit different from the previous weeks, a little more human-centric. Hi, Ranul, good evening. Oops, my mic is, oops, I didn't realize my mic is off. good evening, Ranul. I was saying I hope everyone's had the time to go through the lectures. A little bit different this week with human ecology in focus and how humans are responsible in driving a lot of factors that affect our environment. I think we'll wait for a couple of minutes and let's see. One or two more people and then we can start. All right, I think we're about 4 or 5 people now. Okay, so let's start today's our discussion session will be on human ecology as per the classes that have this week's classes. Let's just go head into the first question. Okay, so the current geologic era designated right now is called the Miocene, Pliocene, Anthropocene, Eocene. Okay. Any other options?
Miocene.
Okay, Miocene. What else? One guess for Miocene, one guess for Eocene. What about the others? Actually, not era, this is epoch rather. So all of these are epochs. Yeah. Okay, so any other guesses? C, okay. One for Anthropocene. Any other Guesses. Okay, so actually, C is the correct answer. And Anthropocene, can anyone guess what the word Anthropocene is derived from? Anthro means humans, yeah, that is absolutely correct. So the thing is that, so before the Anthropocene, just before the Anthropocene, or when we say the Anthropocene began, is the Holocene, right? That's the previous epoch. And this is actually not official, the Anthropocene, the epoch itself, but it is designated because of, why do you think people have come up with this term Anthropocene? When do you think you can name an epoch? Does anyone have any idea? Too many changes? When too many changes are caused by... yeah, sure. But why should we rename this era? Why can't it be still the Holocene? Like, the Holocene is before the Anthropocene, right? Why should we categorize this period, the few hundred years previously till date now, as Anthropocene? Like, you're all on the right track. Okay, rapid, but what is the factor that is affecting all of this? Change in the environment, correct, caused by humans, yes, correct, right? So the Jurassic period was dominated by like the dinosaurs, right? And that's why it is called like the Jurassic age. So the Jurassic epoch. But so the current epoch is proposed to be the Anthropocene because people feel, or the general consensus is, that humans are having such a great effect on the entire planet that the epoch is driven by activities done by humans, right? And this is really cool resource from National Geographic. I've just put the link here. I'm going to take you to this. So basically, the Anthropocene epoch is an unofficial unit of geological time used to describe the most recent period in Earth's history when human activities have started have a significant impact on the planet's climate and ecosystems. Okay, and now we have this, you can go through this whenever you have the time. So officially, the current epoch is called the Holocene, right? So the Anthropocene epoch is an unofficial unit of geologic time used to describe the most recent period in Earth's history when humans have a lot of impact on the climate and the ecosystem, right? And to have an epoch officially named, it needs to be adopted by the International Union of Geological Sciences. The IUGS is this organization or this body that is responsible for designating these epochs, right? And they need to, and how, what is their primary basis? Their primary basis is that to declare an epoch, they need to figure if, like, for example, Anthropocene in this case, like, humans have changed the ecosystem to such a point that it is reflected in the rock strata, right? So that is how we go back in time, and like when you look at fossil records, based on certain fossil records, you can date it back to whatever era the particular organism lived in, because these organisms were classified by that, right? So now if we are classifying this era or this epoch as Anthropocene, it needs to be reflected in the rock strata that humans are having a huge impact on the earth, right? So I'm just going to switch back. So yeah, this is a very short read, but you can check out this link. All right, so the next question. Okay, so here you have a figure. So what does this figure denote? And what are the implications of this phenomenon in the future, right? So take a minute to look at this figure carefully and tell me what's happening. So you have two generations. This is the first generation. This is the second generation. And here you have something being applied before application and after application. So what does this figure telling us? And there are several answers to this. There's like not one, and you feel free to describe it in your own words. This is something that everyone must be quite familiar with and quite knowing this quite well. Does anyone have any ideas, or is the figure not clear? Yes, Yasmin. Oh, okay. Does anyone feel that the figure is not clear? Are these, yeah, they could be beetles. Yeah, sure, we can consider them as beetles. So you have pesticide, right?
Pesticide resistance.
Sorry, Amol?
Pesticide resistance.
Correct, correct. So you are having pesticide resistance that is denoted in this figure, right? As Amol has correctly mentioned. Would you like to explain the figure? Or anyone else would like to explain how pesticide resistance happens? No one? Okay, first generation pesticides, not pesticides, the pests get killed. The pesticide is used to kill the beetles. Okay. Then later they develop resistance and majority survive. Okay, that is not entirely correct, but somewhat correct. Anyone else would like to add on to what Ranul has mentioned?
Madam, it has a genetic basis.
Yes, it has a genetic basis. Would you like to explain this? So what is actually happening here in the genetic basis? What is this? No, Bharat, it's not mutation. Yeah, carry on.
Madam, at genetic level, the resistance develops. The organism acquires the capability at the genetic level to adapt and to counter this chemical, to neutralize the lethal effects of the chemical upon the organism.
Okay, sure. So let's get a little bit deeper into this. So in the first figure out here, you see there are, let's call them beetles. There is one red beetle and there are several white beetles. After the pesticide gets applied, you have two white beetles and one red beetle, right? So, and then it becomes into this. So if there were only white beetles, and then it became this, and then this again had only white beetles, and then there were again more white beetles. I will buy Shabi's argument on saying that the genetic resistance is being developed genetically, but in this case something else is happening. The genetic resistance is not Yeah, that is correct. That's absolutely correct. So it is the red beetles that are having resistance, right? Because this is really clear. And can someone, so you have learned this phenomenon before. Could someone tell me what is actually happening here? What is that term used?
Natural selection.
Yes, selection. Absolutely right. Fantastic. So selection is happening out here, right? So what is happening is that there are two kinds of beetles, and one that is inherently resistant to pesticide, right? And now after you apply the pesticide, your white beetles are much lesser in number, but your single lone red beetle is still there. Okay, yes, to reproduce, you need two individuals, male and female, but this is just for representation purposes. Now, in the second generation, when you see the red beetles have increased in number and so are the white beetles, and then when you apply your pesticide again, the white beetles are killed and the red beetles continue to proliferate, right? Why? Because they are inherently more resistant to the pesticide that you are using. Yeah, is this clear? So this is how pesticide resistance takes place in some cases. Does anyone have any questions on this? So this is the same thing that is seen in the peppered moths. This is a famous example.
Industrial melanism.
Yes, absolutely correct. Yeah, so you had the two morphs, the dark and the light one, and their predation levels differed based on how well they were able to camouflage themselves in the surrounding. And during the Industrial Revolution, the surroundings had become black. So the darker morphs were less visible and the white morphs were more predated on, right? So that is an example of selection. But here, the selection is happening due to an anthropogenic effect, right? Because we are trying to kill these pests by using pesticides. So now, what are the future implications of this phenomenon? Yes, Shabir?
Madam... Madam, it's a cause of concern. It can have serious detrimental impacts on human health, animal health.
Yes, sure. Those are the downstream impacts of using pesticides in general. And what about what is shown in the figure? Like, you are using pesticides like this and it's not really helping, right? It's not serving the purpose of killing pests, because it's just causing more resistant varieties to increase in number.
Yes.
So what do you think could be solutions to this, potential solutions to this?
Madam, biological control using integrated pest management.
Sure, that is a good approach. Yeah, you can use that. Genetic engineering of crop, sure, yeah, that is one approach. Yeah, so I'm glad a lot of you have different suggestions, and there is not really one particular method. There can be like several methods of how to combat this. And also, if you're still continuing to use pesticides, you'll have to use pesticides that have a wide range, that are not single insect specific. But what happens with this is another bigger problem, is that if they are not killing, like targeting a particular species and killing it, if it has a wide range, it ends up killing a lot of other even important species or insects, such as perhaps, let's say, bees or other pollinators that are useful for the ecosystem, right? And you can see this thing even in any viral infections or any other infections, right? So your antibiotics affect like a whole host of bacteria in your body, right? Or your antiviral, like your vaccines affect like a whole host of things. Or there are certain targeted vaccines that affect particular viruses, right? But as you can see, even with like our current pandemic caused by the virus. Like, there are very, very different strains of this that really can't be. And that is actual active mutation that is happening. So since it's a virus and it has an RNA as a genetic material, it is prone to errors and it causes, and it replicates via tons of mutations. And that's why you can't have like a particular vaccine to combat it. Yeah. Yes, you can also use biopesticides. That's all current. Okay. So let's move on.
Madam, biological magnification is another concern associated with the pesticides, because when it comes to food chains and food webs.
Yes, that is correct. You have biomagnification, then you have bioaccumulation. One is within the same individual itself. One is across trophic levels. So, yes, you do have a lot of downstream effects of using pesticides in general. All right. So here is a figure from a really cool paper in the annual reviews of marine science. I don't know, is this figure clear or not really? So basically this tells us, okay, all right. So basically it tells us how human population affects marine ecosystems. And you can take a minute to look at this graph, and then maybe somebody can try and like pitch in and see whether it makes sense or not. Maybe you can describe this. So I can tell you the axis. So here is the year, and so certain parameters have been monitored since the 1800s. Okay. And then on the y-axis, you have multiple different parameters, right? Like global mean sea level in this teal green, summer Arctic sea ice area in yellow, ocean heat content in orange, sea surface temperature in brown, your mean surface pH in blue, and you have carbon dioxide level, dissolved carbon dioxide levels in red, right? Okay, yeah, I'm getting some responses. Okay, global mean sea level increases. Where do we have sea level? Global mean sea level in teal, it's increasing. Okay. Summer Arctic ice area is decreasing, right? Because this is almost directly proportionate to each other, right? So if you have sea levels that are increasing, it is only because a lot of the ice at the polar ice caps especially is melting to increase these sea levels. Ocean heat is increasing. Yes, your average ocean sea temperature and heat increases because water also absorbs a lot of heat and retains a lot of heat, right? They are they absorb like tons of heat. And then you have two important things that are out here. Ocean pH, ocean acidification, yes. So your pH is dropping, right? It's like drastically dropping from about, let's say, I don't know exactly, but about the 1980s, like you can see it's been falling like rapidly down till about 2010 or something. I don't know. This 2012, the paper was from. So 2010, and then you have the CO2, the dissolved carbon dioxide in the oceans are rapidly increasing, right? Yes, overfishing is happening, but Bharat, this that is not mentioned in this, right? So it's basically how it's affecting climate in this particular graph. We are not talking about like the other anthropogenic activities, but yes, overfishing is of course a concern. So what you can see out here, from 2010 to 2100, this area shaded in red is a projected levels, right? And what's happening here, your dissolved oxygen is like absolutely okay. Why is dissolved CO2 is dissolved? Why is that bad? Okay, so the biggest sinks for carbon dioxide on the planet are. What is the biggest sink? Oceans, correct, right? More than forests, it's oceans. Oceans absorb a huge amount of carbon dioxide. And what is happening is that when carbon dioxide gets absorbed by water, it
carbonic acid.
Yes, it forms, correct, carbonic acid. And that causes
lowering of pH,
right? And lowering of pH leads to acidification. Yes, correct, exactly, right? So there's your answer. So as the oceans are getting acidified, the most famous example for ocean acidification is
ocean acidification.
Yeah, example for ocean acidification. Yeah, that is calcium carbonate, but I don't think the ions are breaking up. This actually, calcium carbonate is good for corals, but corals are what? They are a complex of
madam, they are basically a special group of sedentates, madam.
Yes, algae, right? And algae is the one that gives the color to these corals, right? And what happens when the pH becomes too low? It causes bleaching because these algae are actually killed. And then that symbiotic ecosystem between the corals gets hampered. And then the algae is released. And then these corals just become calcium carbonate just structures, right? Without anything inhabiting it. Right? So coral bleaching is really bad. And why is coral bleaching bad? Because corals form a extremely important ecosystem for marine organisms, right? Because you have a lot of fish and a lot of even fauna that is very dependent on the coral ecosystem to survive, right? So once the coral acidification happens, or once coral bleaching happens, not acidification, the entire ocean area becomes barren, right? And all these are linked to, if you see the figure down, you have from the 1800s to 2010, if oceans don't absorb carbon dioxide, then it gets into atmosphere carbon. Yes, that is also true. Yes, you have, anyway, you have overheating of the planet and all those factors that are a problem. So, yeah, everything is bad having, and also we are cutting down so many trees, right? So there's huge levels of deforestation happening. So there's really no photosynthesis that's happening. And we know that photosynthesis is one of the main ways to what does photosynthesis help? Absorb CO2, right? So it fixes CO2 and it's converting it into other carbohydrates, right? So yeah, so this is like a snowballing effect that's happening. And if you see the graph down that is shown at the bottom, you will see that the year is increasing. On your y-axis here, you have relative change and change that is progressing. And then you have relative change also that is here, but it is on a different scale. I think certain figures have different scales, but that's okay. Just look at the general trend, right? So you have, let's go from the bottom, mariculture production increasing. Hypoxic zones, that means less dissolved oxygen, increasing. Cumulative mangrove loss, increasing. Cumulative coral cover over loss, increasing. Seagrass loss, increasing. Marine fish harvest, increasing. So as Bharat, you mentioned, overfishing. Biological invasions, introduction of invasive species into areas that completely overtake an ecosystem. coastal population, number of people inhabiting coastal lands increasing, and all this is correlated to the world population that is increasing, right? So yeah, this is a huge amount of factors that you can see are just linked to human increase and also industrialization, right? So this really shows you how human population does affect marine ecosystems, right? Is this clear, or was this informative? Cool. Okay. Oops. Okay. So next question. So a heavy metal that is found abundantly in the soil after a nuclear fallout and possesses health risks as it is able to replace calcium in the body. Which of the following is this? Which is this heavy metal that I'm talking about? Is it plutonium? Is it uranium? Is it deuterium? Or is it strontium?
Strontium.
Strontium. Okay. So one guess for strontium. What about the others? Okay. Plutonium. Okay. What else? Any other options? Deuterium. Okay. Another one for plutonium. Oh, and this is supposed to be health risks, not earth risks, but a typo there. Okay, so it's actually the correct answer is strontium, because strontium has a very similar structure to calcium, and this is a radioactive compound, right? So strontium, I think it's called strontium 90. So strontium itself is very rare in the atmosphere or on the earth, but it is generated during a nuclear fallout, and it is the term is strontium 90, and the thing is that this radioactive element is able to replace calcium in the body, right? So, which ends up causing a lot of problems. So yeah, it's strontium. Okay. So, moving on to population theories. So, whose theory of population growth shows that talks about exponential population growth and arithmetic food supply growth? Who is the scientist? Malthus. Okay. Would someone like to explain this graph? It's very straightforward. And did someone say
as population grows very rapidly, but the food production is not so much rapidly,
right? Yeah. And then out here you have a point that is like a catastrophic point. Yeah, what you mentioned is absolutely correct. So food supply is arithmetic. It's increasing, like the quantity increases very slowly, and then you have population that is exponential, that explodes really rapidly, right? So this is what Malthus had proposed. Oops. But there are several criticisms to also Malthus's theory of population growth. Not criticisms as per se, but several factors that are not accounted for. So that brings us to, so yes, it is Malthus's theory of population growth. So which of the following criticisms to this Malthusian theory is false, right? So you have to pick the one that is false. So affluence of the society is included in the theory of population growth. Food yield is not arithmetic, the exponential instead. The area under agricultural land has increased exponentially, and technological developments have resulted in exponential agricultural growth. Which of the following statements is false? B. It's false as a criticism, okay? Not to Malthus's theory. This is a criticism. This is a trick question. This is not Malthus's theory, but this is a criticism to Malthus's theory. Okay, a lot of takers for B. Any other guesses? B, okay. A, okay. Okay, so, well, the right answer is A. And why is it A? Yeah, Shabir. Yeah, correct. So, yes, it is not included in the theory of population growth, right? Because population growth, the Malthusian theory just talks about food production in an arithmetic way, right? But food yield, as we all know right now, is not arithmetically increasing, but exponentially increasing in several cases, right? And why is this happening? Why is food yield increasing exponentially? What are the factors?
Due to different technologies are used. Yes,
that is one factor, due to different technologies. Could you give me some examples?
Tissue culture.
Sure. Okay. Then, anyone can give more examples. So, yeah, tissue culture is probably like different, like,
biotechnological techniques.
Biotechnology, yes, different genetic engineering techniques. What else?
Genetically modified plant and organism, yes. Animal.
Sure, genetically modified crops, mixed cropping, green revolution, yes, sure. Also, I'll give you
but a madam, yeah. But madam, there are genuine concerns regarding genetically modified foods, genetically yeah. modified crops.
Sure, yes, that is definitely a genuine concern. And why is that a concern? Is because these GMO, most of these GMO, or I think all of them, if I'm not wrong, cannot be propagated, right? So they don't have seeds. So all these seedless varieties of crops cannot be planted again. So it's not sustainable, right? But it also results in increasing yield. You can have like larger sized vegetables, larger sized leaves of plants, larger sized everything, right? So yes, let's not get into what are the ill effects of GMOs, but it does result in an increase in yield. But what are the other factors? Like if you think of it, how was farming done several years ago and how is farming done now? What are the things that have technological advancements that have come? Apart from all that have been mentioned right now. Do you know of any technological advancements? Okay, so What about tool use? What about equipment use, right? Before, everything was manual labor, right? But now we have, because of technological advancements, we have so much of, BT cotton, again, all GMO stuff. But we have a lot of equipment, right, that can enable us to do things faster. A lot of things are automated. We have harvesters. People don't have to harvest machines that can run on these fields and harvest grain as well as separate the grain from the chaff. You have, yes, irrigation systems. You have, most importantly, tractors, right? So before you used to have plows that were pulled by some domesticated animal, but now tractors can cover the same area in a much faster time, right? So a lot of technology has helped in actually
vertical farming, madam. Vertical farming,
yes, sure. Vertical farming is now moving on to the complete like urban setup where we don't have like fields or large areas to grow, so we tend to grow everything vertically in trays and controlled environments. If you see, that's the same case with humans, right? So now we don't have place to stay. So now we live in high rises, which are like 30 to 50 floors up. So everything just goes up because it can't spread vertically. I mean, horizontally, right? So this in turn leads to point C, where actually you're having the area under agricultural land that is increasing rapidly, right? A lot of grasslands are being destroyed, a lot of forests have been destroyed, and agricultural land is very rapidly expanding. So that is how these technological developments have resulted in the exponential agricultural growth. So in line with the Malthusian theory, food is actually exponentially increasing in today's world. Of course, we are going to hit a cap sometime, but so far this has been happening. So this figure was also there in the lecture, and this is very interesting. So this actually shows us the world population in green, and it shows the annual growth rate of the world population. So what really can you tell me in this by this figure? What is what's happening? What is showing you at, let's say, current between 1950 to 2000, there is a rapid population growth. Okay, yeah. And then 1915 to 2000 or 1915 to, let's say, the 1970s, perhaps 70s, 80s, right? There's a rapid population growth. It's 1968 till it's the population growth rate is 2.1%, right? 1968. And then what's happening? Yeah, it's crashing, right? So the population growth rate has peaked at that point of time and now is gradually declining. But our world population, of course, is still increasing. So I think this figure was made in 2019 and we have hit about 7.7 billion. Yes, due to awareness and policies, population rate is in population rate is decreasing. But why do you think the population level is still increasing quite a bit? So awareness and policies, yes, have decreased the population growth rate, but population is still increasing. Why is that? Yes, very good point, because healthcare is good, and due to better healthcare, death rate is less. Yes, people are living longer. People, the average lifespan has increased a lot. There are several people about the age of 90 who are still alive, 90 to 100 that are still alive. also because of good healthcare, we have a lot less mortalities during birth, and the natality rate is also pretty high, right? So though the annual growth rate has dropped drastically and will continue to drop across time, this is projected till 2100, your population is still going to increase, and we're going to hit about 10.9 billion as of projected in 2100. Okay. So, yeah. So, another thing is, what is the total impact, right? Your total impact by human beings is driven by three factors. You have population, you have affluence, and you have technology, right? So we discussed population. We had a discussion during of technology with respect to agriculture. But what is affluence? Anybody would like to describe what is affluence? So affluence is measured in, what is affluence? Affluence is the amount of money you earn, right? It's defined by the mean income of a population, the affluence, or the GDP, the gross domestic product, right? So basically, it is a proxy of consumption levels, right? So the more affluent you are, the more you tend to consume. And consume means not in terms of just food or the food you like physically eat, but in terms of resources, right? So you use non-eco-friendly resources, you use a lot of fossil fuels because you have a lot of cars, or you have like huge houses that need a lot of electricity, that run, that use a lot of electricity that is generated by some non-renewable means, right? So you have affluence affecting, like contributing to how the humans impact the ecosystem in a big way, right? So affluence is another major factor. Right, so let's just move on to the next question. So the dash, so this particular report was presented by a commission, and it devised the most, the best definition for sustainable development. And it defined it as development which meets the needs of current generations without compromising the ability of future generations to meet their own needs. Right? So where was this? Where did this happen? Or what was the name of this commission? Not where did it happen. What was the name? The report by the... Anybody remembers? So these are the three pillars for sustainability, right? You have the social aspect, you have the economic aspect, and then you have the environmental aspect. You can't look at any three of these aspects independently. You have to look at them together, and then only will you be able to implement sustainability or practice sustainability. Right? Because if you only say cut off the use of coal in India, right? Just cut off this one fine day, just stop using coal. Coal is used in several industries, right? Because it is a depleting resource, of course, and also it is a polluting resource. But a lot of things are running on coal, right? Like you have the, yes, Bharat has given the correct answer, it's the Brundtland Commission. That's right. So you have a lot of things that run on coal, and they can't just change overnight, right? And then you also need to look into the economic background. Like a lot of people might not be able to afford switching to other means of energy, because it's not just the switch that needs to be taken into account. You need to take into account the machinery that can run on the switch, right? So like, let's say, for example, electric scooters or electric cars and non-electric cars. You can't just take a non-electric car that uses petrol and then start charging it, right? You need to have a whole another machinery inside the car to enable it to store electricity that can be used to run it, right? And for that, you need a lot of engineering design, and you need money, and you need like factory production units that will produce this kind of thing. So you have to take like the social aspect, the economic aspect, and the environmental aspect when you are thinking about sustainability. Okay. All right, let's just go to the next question. Okay, so you have the environmental impact assessment. And what is true about this environmental impact assessment? So it is a procedure that ensures the environmental implications of decisions are taken into account when there are evidences of environmental impact in the progress of an activity. It is a procedure that ensures that the environmental implications of decisions are taken into account after the environmental agency grants a permit. It's a procedure that ensures the environmental implications of decisions are taken into account before the decisions are made, or it provides funding to the projects to undertake their work. Okay, so this is one answer for C. What are the other answers? Any other guesses? There's several of you here. How many do we have today? 9? Yeah. 8 of you, okay. What is true about the environmental impact assessment? No other guesses? Does anyone?
C, madam.
Okay. Yeah. So C is the correct answer, because you have to have an environmental impact assessment done before the decisions of whether the project.
Undertaking a project, madam.
Yes, correct. So you have environmental impact assessments that need to be done for various projects, right? All over, whether you need to start up, whether you need to build an airport in a particular place, whether you need to construct a dam in a particular place, whether you're going to clear up a particular site of land to use it for some infrastructural development, right? You need an EIA to be done. And doing an EIA has various different steps, right? And one of the steps is known as screening. So what is the purpose of the screening step in this EIA? Is it to assess the quality of the project design? Is it whether to approve the project or not? Is it to determine whether a full EIA is needed? Or is it to suggest the changes that need to be made to a project?
D, madam.
Okay, one more for A. Yeah, the guess is A.
The necessary changes that need to be made, madam. D.
D, okay, sure. Yeah, so one more for D, okay. Okay, so actually the correct answer is C. So during the screening step, the governing body of this EIA actually decides whether you need to have a full environmental impact assessment or you need to have a partial environmental impact assessment, right? And the part to approve the project comes like absolutely at the end. But to determine whether you need a full or a partial EIA assessment is done during the screening phase of the project. And this is like the first phase, right? Then you have the scoping phase, and then you have like several other phases, as you might have. I think we can just like pull it up out here. Oops, it's not sorting. Okay, yeah. So screening is a very first phase that happens, and they do the screening to determine whether you need a full EIA, which entails a whole host of things that are applied to doing to undertake an EIA, or it needs a partial EIA. And a partial EIA is perhaps when they feel that so many and such amount of resources do not need to be invested. They also see like probably the scope of the project and what are the factors that entail the project, right? So in some cases, you don't need to do an entire impact assessment. You can just do a partial one. And that is what happens in the screening stage. Okay, so last question out here, it's an open question. So all of you know of several clean technology strategies, right? So could all of you, each of you list out particular clean technology strategy, perhaps with some examples. I'd like to hear, okay, there are eight of you, maybe like eight examples. If we can go quickly, we have like 2 minutes. Okay, hydrogen fuels, okay, sure. And what can hydrogen fuels be used in? Okay, sure, for everything, okay. Sure. Cars, yeah, okay. Sure, okay, we can take that as one strategy. What about, okay, next example.
Biofuels, madam.
Biofuels, sure, biofuels that are generated by?
Plants, madam.
Sure, plants, even like waste, yes, biogas generated by waste, yes, sure. What about other examples? Renewables, sure, yes, definitely renewable, solar and wind. Though the trade-off between this is that they are very high initial investments and the payoff rate is pretty long term. So yeah, there is kind of like a moot point between whether you should use solar panels especially, and if they are, yeah, they are definitely a renewable source of energy, but the amount of electricity that is converted from these photovoltaic cells is quite less, and they can also only be used in regions that receive a lot of continuous sunlight, right? And the same for windmills, you need large areas to set up these wind farms. But yes, definitely they are cleaner forms of technology. Sewage treatment, yes, definitely that is one important factor that contributes towards clean technology strategies, because we are generating a lot of waste, right? Even if it's sewage, like wet waste, or if it's even dry waste or plastic, solid waste management, yes, definitely we need to recycle reuse, and reduce, right? The three R's. Recycle means recycle whatever you're using. If you're using a plastic bag or a cloth bag, just keep on using it till it okay, like a lot more examples. Fly ash utilization. I'm not really familiar with this, but you could explain this, Ranman. Groundwater monitoring, sure, yes. We need to coal ash. Okay. All right. Okay. Groundwater monitoring, yes, definitely. We are exploiting water use from the ground without recharging it, right? So you need to have something as simple as rainwater harvesting systems or groundwater recharging systems that collect rainwater and feed them back. Coal ash can be converted to bricks and used in construction. Okay, yes, sure. Yeah, that is, yeah, good. Bioplastic, sure. Environmental remediation. Shankari, would you like to give some examples on environmental remediation? Okay, how that works? Yeah, go ahead. I don't know if you are talking and I can't hear you. Oops. Can anyone hear Shankari? Am I not hearing Shankari? cleaning oil spills. Shavir, I can't hear you either. I don't know if something has gone wrong with the mic of my system. Oops, I'm sorry. I can't hear any of you if you are talking. No, that's not your problem. I don't know if it's my problem and I can't. There's something gone with the microphone out here. Cleaning oil spills using solvents. Yes, definitely. Personal numbers, not really. Please post all your queries on the NPTEL discussion forum because we are just helping out with the questions out here. But I cannot, we are not setting up the papers or anything. And we will also have the last session for any additional questions. So do feel free to attend the last discussion session to ask any questions that you have. And if there are any exam related questions, please do post them on the discussion forum because NPTEL is very prompt at answering them. So, yeah. Okay. All right. I think we have overshot by 3 minutes today. Thank you all for coming and see you all next week.
Thank you, madam.
Yeah. Thanks. Bye. Thank you.